place of power because we are kings and our words matter. It is not going to come upon you automatically. It will only be appropriated by you by faith, and by no other means can it be lived out on this earth, can it be experienced on this earth. Our faith is all. God treats us good. He treats us like people. He doesn't dump it on us.
You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with song of deliverance whenever I am afraid. I will trust in you. I will trust.
Galatians chapter 3, verse 7. Therefore know that only those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. How many of you know that you are sons of Abraham? You are sons of Abraham because you are of faith. You are sons of Abraham. Everybody say, I am a son of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. I want you to note the fact that the gospel was preached to Abraham, it says. We thought the gospel was only after Jesus came. But here it says that the gospel was preached to Abraham. Abraham lived long before Jesus ever came. But it says that the gospel was preached to Abraham. I'm going to bring out some point today because we've been looking at the blessing of the Lord. The blessing of the Lord is better understood if you understand the blessing of Abraham. Because in order for the world to see what God's blessing is like, God had to choose a man who did not know God and bring him to himself and reveal himself to him and bless him so abundantly and make a great nation out of him. Not so that him and his nation alone will be blessed. That is never God's intention, because God is not God of Abraham. He is God of Adam, actually. You must not forget that world started before Abraham started being there. So God started with Adam. So God is concerned about mankind, not just about Abraham and his people. We should not get the wrong idea. But God had to choose a man and make him a nation and set them forth as an exhibit before the world, so that people can see and understand this is what God's people are like. This is how people will be blessed when they trust in God and put their faith in God. So that they will serve as an attraction, that they will attract the rest of the world to this God, the living God. This is the only way God wanted to do it. And that is the whole purpose of the choosing of Abraham and the nation of Israel and God's special purpose for them and so on. So the gospel was preached to Abraham, the Bible says. So the gospel happens to be there even before Jesus ever came. See, before Jesus came, the gospel was preached in the Old Testament or Old Covenant times. It was preached by way of foreshadowings. It was preached by way of foretelling what is going to happen. In the New Covenant, we have the fulfillment of the gospel. In the Old Testament, we have animal sacrifices and so on. Our God doesn't, believe in animal sacrifices, but he wanted that because he wanted to show that Jesus Christ will become the sacrifice, and to picturize that or to foreshadow that, he needed animals and the sacrifice of animals and so on, so that he can teach people concerning the gospel under the Old Covenant and so on. So in the Old Covenant, we have the foretelling of the gospel. In the New Covenant, we have the fulfillment of the gospel. We have the gospel already happened in the Old New Covenant. In the Old Covenant, it is being foretold. So the gospel has always been around. I say this because when we talk about the blessing, a lot of people are not able to believe that the gospel comes as a total package of the blessings of God. They confine gospel to only the forgiveness of sins, that you will come to Christ and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will be saved, that your sins will be forgiven, so that tomorrow when you die, you'll go to heaven and enjoy all God's blessings. This is what is presented to us normally. But the Bible teaches us totally differently. It teaches us that the gospel is not just about forgiveness of sins and later on going to heaven and having the blessings. The gospel is about the blessing that God gave to Abraham and how that blessing now has come down to all of us through Jesus Christ. That is why it says, God, foreseeing the fact that all of us will be blessed through Abraham, preached the gospel to him, saying, in thee shall all the nations shall be blessed. That's the gospel. The gospel was preached to Abraham. What is the gospel? That everybody will be blessed. So the gospel, in essence, is about how everybody will be blessed with the very same blessings that Abraham was blessed with. Now, verse 9. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. Now verse 13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, so that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Jesus Christ. Now I want to stop right there. The cross happened so that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. And so the gospel is about the cross of Calvary and what happened there, how Jesus died there. So that the blessing of Abraham has now come upon all of us who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to go back to it today. Last week we were deep into that subject where we talked about how the gospel includes a whole lot more than just the forgiveness of sin. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Now, this is talking obviously about how you can come to God with all your sins and your sins will be washed away. And God will take care of your sins. He will clean you and make you whole. He says, come. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. That means he'll clean it up. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. God says, come, I'll take care of your sin problem. Now, I've been raised in the Christian background, and in the old days, I've heard so many gospel preaching based upon this particular verse. Isaiah 1:18 is a favorite verse of many evangelists who will preach about, come with your sins. God will cleanse you, wash you, make you whole, and clean you up. And whatever your sins are, come, and God will clean you up. That's a wonderful message. But I don't remember ever anybody going to verse 19. And verse 19 follows upon verse 18. It comes right on top of verse 18. It comes right after verse 18. It is a continuation of what has been told us in verse 18. Verse 18 says, come, we'll take care of your sin problem. Come with your sin. I'll wash it and make you clean. And then verse 19 says, if you're willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the Lamb. Now, this is where Christians have a problem. They have no problem accepting verse 18. They say, oh, praise God, come with your sin. God will cleanse you of your sin. But if you say, if you be willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. They say, well, that is not for right now. We always said the only way we're going to eat any good or only way we're going to have anything good is when we die and go to heaven. That's all we were told. Right now we get nothing. Only when we go to heaven, we'll get everything. But here it is told, come, I'll clean you up, make you whole as far as your sin is concerned. And then after you're made whole, if you then become willing and obedient, that means if you will get your mind right and start believing the right things and start walking in my ways and start believing my word and start believing my promises and start following me. That's what it means, willing and obedient. Then you will eat the good of the land. Now, I told you that that is not sufficient enough because we have good, better and best now in our way of thinking about things. So I told you it literally means not just the good, you will eat the best of the land. That's what it means. It is not the best of heaven. Of course, we'll eat the best of heaven later on when we die and go to heaven. But right now we are here. It is talking about how we will eat the best of the land. Everybody say the best of the land. Why do you think the best of the land is being prepared? Why did God put such resources upon this earth? Why all this technology and all these good things that are happening, why are they happening? People think, well, they are happening, you know, and they're largely in the hands of people that don't know God and they're using it for their purposes. Christians are always complaining. But I want to tell the Christians, it is there for us. God has kept it for God's children to be used for God's purposes. Most of us don't believe it. That's why we don't have it. When we start becoming willing and obedient, when we start willingly embracing this truth, after getting saved, after getting our sins taken care of, when we start becoming willing to embrace this truth, then only we can walk in the blessing. Blessings don't happen automatically. You got to become willing. Willing and obedience is the being willing and obedience is the two conditions upon which the whole thing rests. You can get saved and go to heaven, but if you want to eat the best of the land, you got to become willing and obedient. If you don't become willing and obedient, you'll die and go to heaven, but you will not eat the best of the land. Hello? Are you there? Be very clear about it. You won't miss heaven, but you'll miss every blessing that is here on this earth. You won't miss heaven because the blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed you, but you'll miss everything else. All that God wants to do in and through you, you'll miss it. All the blessings that have been prepared for you, you'll miss it. If you don't get your mind right and become willing and obedient and embrace the truth about how these things are kept there for you, you'll never be able to enjoy it. It is not going to come upon you automatically. It will only be appropriated by you by faith. And by no other means can it be lived out on this earth. Can it be experienced on this earth. Our faith is all. God treats us good. He treats us like people. He doesn't dump it on us. We're not animals. So, you know, you just dump food on them, you know. No. He says, you want to eat? You want to eat the best? I got to eat the best. But you got to believe. You got to come. You got to sit. You got to take. And you got to eat. You got hands. You got a mind. You determine what you're going to eat. You come and eat. He's not going to push it down your throat. He's not going to force you to have it. You are going to come, and by faith, you're going to have it. That's the only way. That's the way God treats us, because he knows that he made us in his image and likeness, so he doesn't force it on us. We'll have to only come, and by believing and by deciding and determining and being willing, we have to come and partake of it. So I want to talk about the willingness part, and then I want to talk about the obedience part later on. But the willingness part, because I want everyone to walk in the blessings of God. That's my goal in preaching this. I'm not preaching just to preach a sermon. I want people to be able to walk in the blessings of God in this life, and really, in your spirit, soul, and body, in the work of your hands, in your finances, in the family life, in every way. Walk in the blessings of God. Eat the best. Do you have the best? Do you enjoy the best? Do you have a best marriage? Do you have the best family? Do you have the best career? Do you have the best in your business? Do you have the best in every way in your life? Are you happy? Do you enjoy your life as you should enjoy with God's help? Is God real to you in these ways? Are you appropriating God prepared blessings that are there for you? Wonderful you are saved, wonderful that you given your life to the Lord, but have you set your mind right and become willing? Have you embraced this truth about the blessings, and are you walking in the blessings? That's the question today. Now, a lot of people are not able to walk in the blessings mainly because they think that salvation or the gospel consists only of forgiveness of sins and then going to heaven. So I've heard some people say, well, you know, people like me, you know, they talk about me and they say, well, he's preaching all these extras. He's preaching the side issues like healing and prosperity and all that. We preach only the gospel. We preach the gospel so that people will get saved and go to heaven one day. But this guy is preaching the side issues. What they mean side issues is healing and prosperity and all of these things, all of these other things that come with it. But I want to show you it is not side issues. It is the main issue. It comes as a total package. It is not side issues. I want to prove it to you today. It is not side issues. So let's look at a few things. And I want to talk about healing just a little bit because I've talked a lot about healing. And I want to say some things about material blessings and so on because that's the area where people have a lot of trouble. Even those who believe in healing, you know, are having difficulty believing in the material blessings. Because I come from a certain background, you know, we believed in healing readily, but we never believed in material blessings. We were always against that, you know. We always thought that's a worldly person talking about material blessings. God never gets involved in that. God never gives that. God has nothing to do with it. This is the way we thought about it. So that's why I want to pay more attention to that today. Because that's where a lot of spiritual people have a difficulty. But I do want to say something about healing. Is healing for today? Is it part of the gospel? Is it part and parcel of the salvation? Or is it part and parcel of the gospel? I showed you the other day when Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The first thing he's mentioned is to do what? To preach the gospel to the poor. There it is. Already material blessings, you know. But a lot of people say, well, that means spiritual poor. Well, how can that be? You know, it doesn't have to do with his material things, they say. But it's very clear. He says, I preach the gospel to the poor. Not only there, when John the Baptist sent people to ask him, do we have to wait for another? Or are you the Messiah that is to come? He said, yeah, the gospel is preached to the poor. Go and tell him. Sick are healed. Gospel is preached to the poor. Tell him that it's happening. I am the one. So there he again mentions it and showed you in many places. In Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 9, he says, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. How though he was rich, he became poor so that by his poverty you may be made rich. The Bible is very clear about these things. So the gospel to the poor, he says. Now, the gospel to the poor is a thing that you don't hear very often these days. If you tell the poor, receive Jesus Christ and keep living poor, one day you'll die and then you got mansions in the sky above when you die. He's not going to say amen to that. No wonder nobody wants to follow that kind of thing, you know. And a lot of people complain about me. They say, well, he's talking about prosperity and blessings. Look at all the people are going after him because he's talking about prosperity and blessings. I said, brother, you please talk about it also. They'll come after you also. I'm preaching the good news. The good news that the way that it ought to be preached. I believe this is the good news that Jesus preached. He preached the gospel to the poor. Do you have anything to say to the poor? Now, you know, we Christians are very good at having orphanages and helping the poor and all that. That's very good. That's a noble cause and we do it very well and so on. And it must be appreciated. We take great pride in doing that. Okay. But why don't we take great pride in telling that Jesus is the answer to the poverty problem of this world? Why don't we tell that also? That's what I'm saying. See, that is why Jesus, you know, when that woman came and emptied that costly box of alabaster oil and washed him and so on. You know, everybody objected and said, we could have sold this and given it to the poor, they said, you know. But Jesus said, wherever this gospel is preached, this will be told. What will be told? That this woman washed his hair with the most expensive alabaster oil? What is the good in telling that? What will be told? He said, wherever the gospel is preached, this will be told. You know why he said that? He said, she's preparing me for my death. That is why she's doing this. Leave her alone, he said. She's preparing for my death. While others said, let's sell this and give it to the poor, she was preparing him for his death. He was going to die and she was pouring the oil upon him and preparing him for his death, he said. So what he meant was, everybody believed that the way to solve the poverty problem of the world is to take what we have and try to sell it and give to the poor. That's the solution to the problem. They all look at it naturally. But this woman has received an understanding, a revelation. She believes that he's going to die, and in that death is the solution to the poverty problem. That is what will be told. He said, that is why he said, this will be told wherever the gospel is preached. What is to be told? The thing that is to be told is, the poverty problem of the world is not going to be solved by all our noble efforts, however good they may be. Let's all do it, because, you know, if, you know that's all done, and that's very practical and so on. And when somebody comes to us for food, we give him food. Somebody comes to us for clothes, we give him clothes. And the Bible tells us to do that. But the thing is, the solution is not what we can do. The solution to the poverty problem is what Jesus has done when he died on the cross of Calvary. I do what I can. If somebody came to me and said, I haven't eaten anything, I'll probably give him food. But the solution is not me giving food, because I can't give him food every day. The solution is what Jesus has done on the cross of Calvary, right? Now that is what I'm trying to get across to the people here. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, look at the body first. Verse 13. Foods for the stomach and the stomach for foods. That's the philosophy of the world. When you say stomach, everybody thinks food. When you say food, everybody thinks stomach. They think food is for the stomach and stomach is for the food. They match. Like the shoe fits the feet. The shoe is for the feet and the feet is for the shoe, you know. So they look at the stomach this way. The food is for the stomach and the stomach for the food. Look at what Paul says. He says, food's for the stomach and the stomach's for the stomach for the food. But God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. I want you to note and underline that phrase, the body is for the Lord. Everybody say with me, the body is for the Lord. This one thing every Christian has to understand. Why do we have a body? Why do we have a body? The Bible clearly says the body is for the Lord. We have a body because the Lord needs our body. Why does he need our body? Because if he wants to operate on this earth, if he wants to go somewhere, he's got to go through this body. If he wants to do something, he's got to do it with my hands. He's got to go somewhere with my feet. In the world, that is the way he's got to operate, through human beings, in body. So the body is for the Lord. Everybody say, body is for the Lord. And the Lord for the body. What amazing philosophy here. Everybody thinks stomach for the food, food for the stomach. That's the highest that they can go in their philosophy. The Bible says, the body is for the Lord and the Lord for the body. So when you think of the body, you always think, this is for the Lord. And when you think of the Lord, and you think of him as, he is the one that wants to come and live in the body. Did you know the God of heaven, who lives in absolute splendor and opulence in heaven, did not want to live there? He came down to earth. And he did not even want to live and walk on this earth. He wanted to get into the hearts of men. That is why he died on the cross. The most preferred place for God to live is us. Think about that. He doesn't want to live in heaven. He doesn't want to live anywhere. He wants to live inside of us. That's what the Bible teaches. Now listen to verse 19. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? Of whom you have from God, and you are not your own. Don't you know, he says, a lot of Christians don't know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who's in you, and whom you have from God, and you are not your own. Everybody say, I'm not my own. And listen to this, verse 20, for you were bought with a price. Now, everybody knows that we were bought with a price, but we don't think of the body as being bought with a price. A lot of Christians have to get an understanding of this. Listen to this. For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. That means when he paid the price, he prayed not only for your spirit, but also for your body. I want to tell you that God has paid a price and bought your body. It belongs to the Lord. It doesn't even belong to you anymore. It belongs to the Lord. You need to dedicate this body to the Lord and do with the body only what God wants it done. Go where he wants you to go. Do what he wants you to do. Live like that. And then you see how well the body is. The body is for the Lord and the Lord is for the body. The owner of the body is not you. You are the custodian of the body. You are the steward of the body. You are in charge of this body. You have been given this body, but the owner is the Lord. That's the view that the Bible teaches. Right? Now that is why I believe that healing is for today. Because God wants this body well. Because God wants to work through this body. Even though death is still there, death is the last enemy that will be taken care of, that is not yet dealt with yet. Well, he has dealt with it, but death in human beings is going to be dealt with later on, where there will be death no more, the Bible says. There's going to come a day when there will be death no more. But right now, God has given us healing and health and all of these things because he wants to use this body. As long as we are healed and as long as we are healthy, then our bodies become useful bodies for him. That is why he wants this body well and healed and in good health.
Let's put our hands together as we sing. Keep on striving.
Wickedness.